Morning. How awkward is that? I had to get my tea. Not many of you knew I was doing that, but anyways, it's great that that you guys sat here patiently waiting. The lights show up, the lights come on. Nobody's up here. Some of you are wondering, what am I missing here? You're like, what's going on? There's nothing up there. Some of you are wondering, what happened to Ken? Is he all right? Thanks for looking for me. The odd person maybe said a prayer for me, and I thank you for that. I need all the prayers I can get. But unexpected silence can be pretty awkward, can it? As you guys just witnessed, it can be a little unnerving, it can be a little unsettling. It was unsettling for me, let me tell you. That's a long, like, I think it was only like 20 seconds, like, but it seemed like forever, didn't it? At least to me it did. Some of you got uncomfortable in your seat as you had a moment of silence, and maybe you could actually start hearing the voices in your head. Some of them are like, I don't like to listen to voices in my head, let me tell you. Or maybe you got to hear silence, and it's because you were excited because as a parent, you don't get to hear silence very often, right? It's like, oh, it's so peaceful. Or maybe it's, you know what, things are pretty quiet in here. What are the kids doing? What's happening? But what if you asked God something and he was silent? What if you had just a burning question in you and you just keep asking it and you're met with an empty stage? Lights on, nobody's home, God's not talking. There was an expectation, maybe a request, a deep need. You need an answer to your why questions. Some of them we've been going through, and hopefully we've been able to shed some light on some of those why questions that you have. Maybe it's health for healing a broken heart, or maybe it's a simple healing of maybe I just wounded my hand and I just need a healing. Maybe it's a big healing. You've got a sick child at home. And you're praying and you're asking and the stage is empty. Maybe a little rest from some stress or anxiety from work or life. Maybe you just need some help with some directions in life. You continue to kneel. You relentlessly prayed to God. You read all the books. You Googled all of the Bible verses. I know you have. I know you guys are sitting here quietly, but you've meditated on his word and you're met with a God that is silent, a God that you know and trust and love isn't speaking. He's not saying a thing, not even a peep. God, I've lost my job. I've lost my brother. I've lost someone close to me. I've lost a family friend. I have no money. I'm about to go bankrupt. And you're just met with straight up awkward Ken silence. Just seems like it's a one-way conversation, right? We've all been there. Can I agree? Yes, we've all been there. What do you do? What do you do when the God of the universe, the creator of all things, the life changer, the life saver, the life giver, isn't giving you a darn thing? Why are you not hearing me, Father? Where are you? I'm pleading with you. Where are you? I need an answer. Speak to me. I need you. So what do you do if you don't hear? When you can't get nothing from God, and I know I could just keep asking these questions, and I'm gonna tell you today, you're probably gonna leave with more questions than you're probably gonna leave with answers. Isn't that amazing? I'm just going to be straight up with you. I don't have a main point. The main point is going to be what you're going to do and the questions that you're going to ask, okay? So just know, you're going to go home with homework. So why? When you get nothing from God, God, what do I do? Where do I go? Why did this happen to me? And you haven't heard from God in some time. We call this a season of silence. Do I have you all anxious now? Like you guys are like, oh my gosh, all these questions. I get anxious reading this because I'm like, oh, I've been there. Whew, so what do? Do you give up? Do you keep trying? Do you put your big boy pants on and just push through because that's what you are always taught to do? I grew up in a Christian home. We love God, so I just know. I just know, and whatever. I'm just going to go on life. God's going to look after me. You know? I don't need to hear from him. Do you keep leaving messages on God's answering machine in hopes that he'll pick up? And I got to... Yes, answering machines for some of the young ones were a thing. You guys call it voicemail there. I dated myself with answering machines, but I'm going to tell you guys, I'm not as old as 8-tracks. The ones that are laughing, no. Records are still cool, people. So today's message, as you can gather, is why is God silent? And like I said, I'm not going to have all the answers, and I'm just going to give you just small snippets of what you can do and why God might not be speaking. But when God is silent, it's a very personal thing. It's not like this blanket, like, here, I've got all the answers, and now you guys run with it. No, I don't have all the answers. And because that's something that you're going to have to meet God with to find out why. But I'm just going to give you some ideas. You guys can have some questions when you leave. And hopefully those questions are questions that you can ask yourself or ask God. And maybe you guys can start pushing through if you are going through, a season of silence. So does that work for you? Mm-hmm. Next page. So God being silent is actually biblical. I think if you go through the Bible, there's a number of people that go through some moments of silence. A few of them, just right off the top, is Job. Job in chapter 30, verse 20, I cry to you for help, and you do not answer me. I stand, and you only look at me. King David, in one of the Psalms, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest. Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 2 to 3, God, how long do I have to cry out for help before you listen? How many times do I have to yell, help, murder, police, before you come to the rescue? And I'm going to tell you, if you guys want a great book on why is God silenced, that's it right there. I mean, we could go on forever just in that book alone, Habakkuk, because God speaks very clearly about how he works sometimes. And so put that on your list of reading this week. Yeah? I see y'all writing that down. Yeah, Ken said. I look at Abraham and Sarah, they actually went through almost 25 years of silence. If you can imagine not hearing from, you've got requests, and for 25 years, now it was broken up. The first part was about 10 years, and not that that makes it sound any better, right? And the second part was about 13 years. So he too went through a period of silence from God, and it happens. It's going to happen. We're all going to, I believe, go through this. It's not a you thing. It's an us thing. It's a me thing. So, why is he silent? And I'm just going to give you a few ideas here, and there's no way I can touch on everything. Like I said, it's very personal, but I'm probably going to be giving you lots of questions and not answers today. So please, if you have questions, you guys have these little connect cards that are probably around there. There's a note section on the back. Take some notes. I encourage you to take some notes today as you try and process what moment of silence, what season of silence you're going through, and maybe what questions I need to be asking myself or asking my Father as I go through this season of silence. Let's see, he has spoken, and we just haven't been listening. Sometimes we get really busy in life. Sometimes we ask God and we petition God and we pray to God and we're on our knees. Sometimes he's already spoken, but you weren't there to listen. What were you doing that would cause you not to listen? You know, when you actually look at the definition of listening, it means to give attention with the ear. So that's hearing. But it also talks about paying attention. And so paying attention means that not only do you have to listen with your ears, but you also have to listen with your eyes and your heart. It's one thing to hear, but the other thing to actually be open and paying attention and listening, waiting in anticipation. I've asked something, I need to receive in something. But the only way I'm doing that is by making sure that I've got clear ears and that my eyes are open and that my heart is ready to receive. And I'll tell you about my kids. They're not here. And now there's my wife, so I can throw them under the bus as much as I want today. I'm kidding, wife, if you're going to watch this later. I love you. No, but anyways, my kids. And I think anybody with kids has gone through this experience, right? They ask a question, when are we going to the mall? And you give them the answer, we're going to go to the mall after we have lunch. 30 seconds later. Dad, when are we going to the mall? Any parents experience that? All the time, okay? Why is it that my kids are not listening or getting the answers? Because they're not listening. They're not paying attention when I give the answer. Here's the question. Here's the answer. And then 10 minutes later, God, why is this happening to me in my life? And you're not listening because you've moved on. You've moved on to the next thing. My kids are busy coloring. And God's saying, stop coloring. You've asked a question. Listen for the answer. Pay attention. So are you too busy for God? Are you too busy? And again, these are just some of these questions that you need to ask yourself. If I'm petitioning God and I'm asking God, Father, why? Are you actually ready to listen? Did we miss it? Are you too busy? How's your work-life balance? I mean, a lot of us have some pretty demanding jobs. And so you're asking God, why did this happen to me? And then you go to work, and then your life is consumed by work, and we'll touch on that in a little bit. But just some things to think about. Are you listening when God says the answer? One of the other reasons I haven't responded to the last thing he said. So God has spoken. But he needs you to finish doing what he asked you to do to begin with, and you didn't. You didn't respond with what you needed to respond with. And God's like, I just need you to go back here for a moment so we can deal with this before we can get you to start moving on. Are you ready to hear? Are you ignoring it? God, what is it that you would have me do? Did you take any action? Did you even catch it at all? I remember, one of my cohorts at one of my previous employers, she thought she hated me, or I hated her. She thought she hated me? No. She thought I hated her. And I'll tell you why. Is because every time we had a conversation, every time that we met up and she had a question, or I had a question, we would meet up and we would have this conversation and then I would walk away thinking the conversation was done. And she would always come back to me and she's like, why do you hate me? I'm like, I don't hate you. I think you're a great person. She's like, why do you keep walking away from me in the middle of a conversation? And I'm like, in the middle? Sorry, I thought it was at the end of the conversation. But what I was doing is, as soon as I got what I needed from the conversation, I hit the road, not realizing that there was still more to come, that there was still more stuff that I needed to do. But I got what I needed, so I kept missing out a few of the most important points. And those are the things that I needed to do here, so that way I could get to here. And I'm trying to get here, and I can't figure out what I'm missing here. And so I needed to go back. I needed to get back here to hear everything again, so that way I could move forward. So how often do you leave God hanging? How often have you asked God a question and you got a partial answer, which you thought was the full answer, and then you just walked away, and now you want the next thing to happen and it's not happening, and then you go back and figure out, oh my gosh. So is there something that you needed to do that God had already told you to do or asked you to do, not told you, asked you, because you have a choice here, people. You have a choice to either continue to move forward or to stay in your moment of silence, right, in your season of silence. That's a choice you're going to have to make. But God's saying, just, hey, come on back. I've got more stuff for you that you need to complete, that you need to work on, that you need to grow in before you can start moving forward. So have I responded to the last thing he said? Or maybe you're just not ready to hear. And this could be a couple of things. Maybe you just don't want the answer. Maybe you're just like, why is this happening? I don't think I want to know. Or maybe you do want the answer, and you're just not ready to hear. And when I say you're not ready to hear, I mean that you're not spiritually ready to hear the answer that God has for you. Are you growing to a point where you can handle the answer from God? First Peter 2:2-3, like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted the Lord is good. So this isn't about, when we become saved in Christ, when we initially give our heart to Jesus, we're just like babies. We have to grow. We have to learn. We have to understand what God did for us, so that way we can grow in our faith and our spiritual maturity. So that way when God responds, we can respond, or we can maybe do it because we have that maturity, that confidence, that surety in Christ, in our Father that says, yeah, I got this now. But maybe you weren't ready 6 months ago. But God's saying, hey, you're ready now. It's why we encourage new believers to read the book of John before we get them to read the book of Revelations. Because you have to need to understand what Christ did for you on that cross, so that way you can fully grasp the grace and love that God has when he comes back. It's why we don't teach string theory to elementary kids. Unless you're Sheldon Cooper. So are you growing spiritually? I mean, are you really doing the legwork? Are you part of a small group? Are you reading your Bible every day? Are you praying every day? Are you meeting him? And you might feel like he might not be meeting you. But your action is, are you coming to him? Are you meeting him? Are you in community? Are you actively growing and participating in your faith? And only you can answer that. But I'll be honest, it's in the fruit, really. It's in the fruit of what you're going to produce as you start growing in your maturity in Christ and maturity in your faith and spirituality. So what can you do? What can you do? And if just a few reasons why, I hope that spoke to a few people anyways. I believe God has some things to say today, and I think there's a few people that have come today expecting this, that have this question top of mind. God, why? Why are you silent? And so my hope is that you are going to leave with something today. If all of you, maybe just most of you, I don't know, but some of us just, got to push through, including me. So what can you do? Don't ignore the silence. You have to embrace it. This is your opportunity at this point to grow in your faith, to draw closer to God, meeting him in prayer and meditation, in his word, in his world. You know, when I say in his world, I got to tell you. So, some of you may know that I'm a chairperson of Whispering Pines Camp, which is a camp out in Elkwater. And just as a side note, I think we have now 4 chairs of Whispering Pine Camp that attend this church. So there's a lot of people here that love camp. And I got to be honest, when I went on this board initially a few years ago, I was like, what is a Whispering Pines Camp? I've never heard of it before. And some of you are probably wondering, wow, what is that? No, come talk to me later. I can tell you about it. But it wasn't until I actually went out there that I understood, when I was in God's world, when I was in the space that God was growing kids, that I truly understood what it meant to be in God's world. It grew me, and I was excited because I had questions. Why am I here? Why am I doing this? Is this really my space to be in? And do I need to keep? And once I got out there, God just said, here, this is why. And I was like, oh, I get it. I was out there. I was in it. You have to be participating in order to grow in your faith. You just can't show up at church on Sundays and say, I'm good for the week, people. God, why aren't you answering my prayers? No, that just doesn't happen, people. This one little snippet today is great. And let me tell you, we have an amazing worship band. We've got a great volunteer team that is here that is excited about sharing the gospel message to a hurting world outside these doors. And it's amazing. But these people are participating and they're growing in their faith. And as they grow, as they mature, they'll start to bear more fruit. Some fruit, a lot of fruit. It's a whole bowl of fruit. I had to run on a tangent there for a second so I could find my place. So I know it can't be easy at times, and I know it's frustrating when you're waiting for answers and you're just straight up met with silence. But this is your opportunity to turn your test into a testament, to turn your scars into stars. I know those are kind of cheesy cliches, but man, if that's the one thing you remember today, is that when you're going through a moment of silence, as I feel that God might be testing you, and that just needs to turn from that test into a testament. You need to share that. God's just saying, hey, I've got great things for you, and you need to share it. Once my glory is shone through it. The next thing is we need to go back to what we know. Sometimes we're in areas where we're kind of in uncharted territories. You know, we're scared, we're fearful. We just don't understand why God is silent. Sometimes we just need to go backwards and just stand on the promises that God has for us in our life. Things like God loves you. Romans 8:38-39, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ. God loves you. Stand firm on that. You are redeemed and have an eternal home in heaven. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. There was nobody there to baptize, so. But in all honesty, he's prepared a place for you. You need to stand firm. God loves me. My future is secure. God knows you inside and out. Psalm 139, for it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. He knew you from the beginning. He knew your name before you were even formed in your mother's womb. And you know what else? God makes wonderful things. So what does that make you? Wonderful. Y'all are wonderful. Stand firm on that. Pardon me. That's that tea that I went for earlier. Strength is found in your faith. For if God is for you, who can be against you? Romans 8:31. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You should be stronger on the other side of the silence, but you need to just make sure that you're listening and all of that stuff, but you're just standing firm on his promises. You need to go backwards a bit in order to move forward. Stand on those promises. And you'll be guaranteed that you'll be stronger on the other side of the season of silence. The next thing is that you guys need to choose sides. I need to choose sides. I know the struggle as much as anybody else. This is a crazy world out there, is it not? So we need to choose sides. Do we serve the world or do we serve God? Joshua 24:15, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the God of the Amorites, in whose land are you living? But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. You can't adequately serve God and serve this world. You can't have 100% serving God and 100% serving the world. You can't serve money. You can't serve the money God and serve God. You can't serve the work God and serve God adequately. You can't serve the sports God and serve the real God adequately. And just so you know, the sports God says the Oilers are the best. That's right. But I guess what I'm just trying to say is God first in everything. God preeminent. God's up here. Everything else is second to God. So who are we serving? So if we're serving God, great. That's just going to make life so much easier through your moments of silence, through your seasons of silence. If I'm just going to sit and busy myself at work, or if I'm just going to busy myself shopping, if I'm just going to busy myself doing all the things other than actually meeting God, am I going to get through this? I don't know. But I know I will if I'm serving God before I serve the world. And I think this is also an opportunity for you to trust more, not less. This is your time to trust that God is with you. God just doesn't take you somewhere and abandon you. God just doesn't say, hey, I'm going down this road. Sometimes we may move and shift from where God wants us to be, but God's over here. And it was you who shifted. If God is taking you somewhere, he's not going to abandon you. There's a reason why he has you there. But you need to know that he's with you. He won't abandon you. Your faith may be challenged, but take this as an opportunity to stretch and grow your faith. I don't know if this is for me. Why did this happen? Why aren't you giving me an answer? Far too often we have people that leave the faith because they can't get answers. They don't trust in a God that is there with them. God is just wanting you to trust him. So this all reminds me of just an amazing story in the Bible. It's Joseph. Joseph can be found in Genesis. For some of you who know that story, it's an amazing story. For some of you who don't know, it's about some guy with an amazing Technicolor dream coat. Some of you may know that. I encourage you to open up your Bibles to that and read that this week too. But here was a guy that was in the favor of God. His parents treated him great. He was educated. He was smart. He was the baby of the family, so he was a spoiled brat. I can say that because I was the baby in the family and I was spoiled. Maybe he was a little boastful, but definitely had the disdain of his brothers. His brothers had such a hate on for their little brother. I got to tell you, being the, I have three older brothers, and there was quite an age gap between us. I was beat on hard as a kid. It was terrible. But I still love them all. And this has nothing to do with this. But one day, maybe it does, I don't know. They could have kidnapped me, like they did with Joseph in the Bible. They could have kidnapped me, beat me, threw me down a well, but they didn't. But Joseph's brothers did. And if that wasn't enough, how about a little human trafficking? You know, Joseph was sold into slavery in Egypt, where he became a slave of Potiphar, and that's Pharaoh's chief steward, Pharaoh being the king of Egypt, or God really is what they were seeing there. Potiphar's wife falsely accused him of rape and sent him to prison. And this just wasn't like any old prison. And in fact, if you go to Psalm 105:18, because it doesn't really describe it very well in Genesis, but in Psalm 105:18, it says, they bruised his feet with shackles and his neck was put in irons. This was the king's prison. This is like bad people went there. So this wasn't a place where great things happened, but he was almost forgotten there. He interpreted a couple of dreams down there that came to fruition. One guy died, the other lived. It was the cupbearer of the king. Finally, after a few years, the cupbearer said, "Oh my gosh, Pharaoh, you've been having these dreams. I know a guy." And he was remembered. And so he's brought before Pharaoh to interpret a dream. And then, for some of you that know the story, Pharaoh basically loved this guy, loved him so much that he made him second over everything in Egypt, only second to Pharaoh, like a prime minister kind of deal. Israel came into Egypt, and the Lord made his people very fruitful. So listen here, people. Joseph, at any time, could have walked away from God, from his faith, and he had every right to. If you were beaten, left down in the bottom of a well, and God is silent, not saying anything to you, who's God? Why am I here? Why is this happening to me? And then to be dragged out of that well and then sent off to slavery. God, what is going on? He had every opportunity to say, you know what? This isn't for me. Why is this happening to me? I'm going to start doing things under my own volition. I'm going to start doing things my way. Thrown into jail. Hanging out with all those people that were hanging out in prison. Probably made some friends. Probably didn't make some friends. But he stuck through it. He probably felt, you know what, from the time that he was beaten and sent down into that well to the time that he was risen as second in Egypt, only second to Pharaoh, 13 years had gone by. 13 years had gone by from the time that he was at the bottom of that well to the time that he was risen up. And where was God in that all, in all of it? He could have walked away, but he embraced it. He pushed through it. His dad taught him everything. And you know, it's a great thing actually just to mention here about us. What are we teaching our kids? Because when we teach our kids and they go through seasons of silence or they go through problems in life, and if we can teach them at home how to get through this, they're going to do what Joseph did, is when he gets into those tough times, he's going to make it through. He's going to be okay because we gave them the tools and the resources that they need to succeed. He was educated. He knew the promises and the power of God. He chose to continue to serve God in all the adversity he had faced for those 13 long arduous years. His trust was always in God, that God was with him. So why did Joseph have to go through this? There's a great question. Why did Joseph have to go through this? And it's because God had a plan. And it's a plan that Joseph may not see to the end. I remember a couple of years ago, we had a Bible study, a group study in small group, life groups, cell groups, some of you may call them. It was called The Story. And the guy that did the videos, his name was Randy Frazee, but he always talked about the upper story and the lower story. There was the upper story that God saw and God's bigger plan, and there was the lower story when we only got to see what we got to see because that's all we needed to see. But that we played such an important role in this lower story, so that way God's glory could shine in the upper story. So Joseph may not have seen what the whole upper story was, but he did see that God was working in his life, that he was able to get to the position that he was in. Israel was able to come into Egypt. They got through a famine. He helped his family, and he lived a good long life. But had he decided to walk away, had he decided to say, I'm done, signing off, terminating my contract, here's my 7 days notice, I'm out of here, we wouldn't have things like, we wouldn't have an Exodus, we wouldn't have a Moses, we wouldn't have 10 commandments. It was very important that what Joseph did in his time was just a small piece in a much larger puzzle. So all this to say, God's plan, it's not your plan. Another cliche, but it's so true. Here's the thing, guys, we have all these questions. We're in these moments of silence, these seasons of silence. We're not getting our questions answered. But God has a plan for you in his life. He's got a purpose for you. All he's saying is stick with me and I'll stick with you. You may never see the fruit of what you're going through down the future. I think of all these kids at camp, all these kids that were shared a gospel message. They may not have raised their hands or said anything at that point, but what we will never see is the impact that that kid had at camp hearing a gospel message. And that may not happen tomorrow. That might not happen for 7 days. That might not happen for 10 years. But what they will know is eventually they're going to remember that Jesus Christ loves me. I have a God that loves me, that's always with me, and it's because of camp that I heard. It's because Dave sat up here in a pulpit and shared this message, and I walked out not agreeing, but then as life got hard, as I couldn't understand, God just, he's there. Stick with him. You need to trust that this is all for his glory. And his glory will be shown. Let's pray. Jesus, today, we just simply ask that you just give us ears to hear and eyes to see your greatness in all things, including silence. I pray that we will not only just have the ears to hear, but you'll open up our eyes as to how you are moving in our lives and our hearts to love every moment of life that you give us. Maybe going through a moment of silence, a season of silence. Lord, I pray that I just stay with you. I trust you, and I'm going to stand firm on the promises that you've made.